invited to Wirral's Holocaust Memorial commemoration this afternoon. And one of the things that was highlighted to us was that if you had a minute silence for every one of those 6 million Jews that were killed, then you'd be silent for 11 years. And for me, that was quite stark when I heard that. So what I'd like to do is just have a minute silence at the beginning of the meeting, and just to remember those that were in the Holocaust and how it was afterwards, when you think about Bosnia and the former Yugoslavia, that unfortunately continued. So if we can just have a minute silence at the beginning. And we have apologies from Suzanne Edwards, but we have Sharon Vernon, Head of Ops Learning Disabilities, Neurodevelopment Disorders and Acquired Brain Injury, taking Suzanne's place this evening. Do we have any other apologies that we don't know of?
No, we have apologies. So we have apologies from Mel and Cap.
Right, okay, thank you. I invite members to declare any interest or that there's been part of the arrangements. Sharon?
I'm not the NHS.
Thank you. Christina?
Yes, I'm going to school in the NHS.
Thank you. Tony?
Also, thanks for the social care.
Thank you, Joe.
Two daughters who work for the NHS.
Thank you. Councillor Gilchrist?
Yes, I'm the Governor of CWP nominating by the Council.
I work for the NHS. I'm also company secretary of the charity raising funds for the NHS and I'm also going to the NHS.
Okay, thank you. Taking everybody's been through the minutes, and do we have any amendments to those minutes? I've noted one on page 3, and it's the second to last paragraph. In the called in business of the pool fund arrangements, and it notes that Dr. Derek Timmins said he stated that MPs had advised against it signing. I think what he said was two MPs. So if anybody objects to that, otherwise I think we can have that note amended. Does anybody else have anything?
Yes, which isn't in here. I've got one daughter who's a GP, and one who works at the NHS.
slight change to the agenda. Item 4, we have the winter pressure arrangements. I'm actually bringing forward item 8, which is the pool fund arrangement scrutiny workshop report. But the reason for doing that is I left towards the end of that meeting, and the chair of children's committee sat in, and Councillor Cllr Joe Walsh offered to come along this evening should there be any questions, but I'm not able to answer because I wasn't there. So, okay, so I don't know if we have any questions on that that the members want to ask.
I wanted to ask if, as part of the conclusions and recommendations, a part of it that I'm a bit confused about is urgent care major transformation. It's mentioned in the Section 75 agreement. Would this be able to override any results from the consultation, the urgent care consultation, conclusions from that, being that there's one vote teachers there from the CTG and the council, and we're not clear on the if one voted for one thing, one voted for the other, we're not clear on the
I'm sorry, could you just tell us whereabouts in the report you are?
On the recommendations.
Okay, 72.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 recommendations. I think I asked in the workshop, I sent an email previously, I would like some answers if that's appropriate. The urgent care major transformation is in the contract, the Section 75 contract. How does that relate to the urgent care consultation that's presently going on at the moment, commissioned by the CCG? How do them two decision-making processes overlap? Because there's one vote for the CCG on the Section 75 agreement and one vote for the council. I'm not 100% sure, I don't think it's their name or someone, but like me, what the dispute process is if the council vote for one thing and the CCG vote for the other. Can one override the other? Or?
I'm going to ask Ray to pick that up too.
Okay. Rated services in Section 75 do contribute to education, some of them, particularly those services which described as being within the Better Care Fund. Those services do not form part of the urgent care consultation. There is a separate consultation there. The consultation input was fed back to the CCG in December. I think there's there may be a question later on about the urgent care consultation and where that took to. But it is a completely separate process. So the CCG is consulting on the urgent care provision, and that doesn't form part of the Section 75 agreement. If there is a decision in relation to urgent care, it will be a decision that the CCG governing body board makes. So it wouldn't be a council decision in terms of the range of services that have been consulted upon, none of which are part of this.
Christina,
could I ask if
the
into any other Section 75
agreement that we have? No, the other Section 75s that we have are for the health and care social work side of the provision. One with Cheshire Rural Partnership Trust, which is for all age disability services. And the third Section 75 is with the Rural Health and Community Trust for social work provision at community level. So those two things are separate to decisions around urgent care.
Thank you, everybody.
And there's one form of immediate update for the government. From time to time, we can bring experts in to help us to scrutinise. So as we're looking at different perspectives. I'm looking at recommendation 6. Does that make it clear in the process of inviting an expert or another perspective? I'm thinking of Save on NHS or Defend on NHS with some of the experts that were attached to them and the experts we brought in during the calling. So what is the procedure to do that? Does it go through the chair or?
I think this was a question that came up after I left, so indulgence, I'm going to ask Tom to pick that up.
Yeah, just if it, it helps at all, Chair, I believe Councillor Norbury asked that question after you've left him and to approve the chair in the meeting. And I think one of the positives of the workshop was having frontline staff there who were, you know, practitioners and who could tell us about the day-to-day effects of a Section 75 agreement being in place. So we did have, you know, qualified practitioners and, you know, frontline staff who were there to actually answer any of our questions, and that was one of the most interesting parts of the workshop, I think. What we do need to be careful about is that scrutiny is an information gathering exercise, and we should go to qualified practitioners and not necessarily political groups, because scrutiny is not meant to be political, and whether we have sympathy with these groups as our roles as councillors outside of scrutiny, that doesn't necessarily tell us anything about, you know, how appropriate it would be for them to comment on an information gathering session in a scrutiny workshop. As well, you know, as councillors, we can approach any sort of group or any residents or you know, people or organisation that we want to and bring their comments forward to a workshop like this. So we're the kind of conduit of you know, things that need to be raised. So I hope that helps, Chair.
Not really, Chair. Can I have this,
yeah,
a supplementary?
Can you just bear with me, please?
Yeah, no problem.
Christina's had a hand up for some time as well. Well, thank you for that, Tom. I also found, up to the time I left, that the people that were there as witnesses were grassroots experts, as I saw it. So
no,
I thought that was very useful.
So you have just come out on the point of order, if you don't mind.
Well,
the point of order is that there is not the question I asked.
Tony, I'm going to move on to Christina, and then I'll take your next question. Thank you, Christina.
Thank you, Chair. And thank you for that, Tom. I found it, you know, what you were saying, helpful. I think I would have found it a little bit more helpful if it had come, as a number of us had asked, from across the board. Because I'm sure you agree with me that whilst it's very good and very useful to hear from health professionals and social services professionals in their working together capacity, we also really need to look at the people who are having the advantages of all this. And we didn't really have any of those, and we didn't really have anybody from, say, the unions to talk to us about the practices involved. And it was interesting, but for me, it was kind of very one-sided. I hadn't realised that these people were coming. I think I probably would have been invited, asked to invite some other people. And thank you, Tom, for saying that we can talk to our residents, and I'm pleased that we can. I do feel that we are here to represent the voice of all sections of our borough, and it might be easy to say that some things are political and some things aren't, but I think we need to give them the test to see whether that's the case.
Okay, thank you, Christina. It does say in recommendation 6 that it is about service users or those close to service. So I honestly felt that those people were, I take your point about talking to trade union representation, and we've done that in the past, and it's been really useful. But at that workshop, I think that, this is from my own viewpoint, that those people that were there were very much on the front line, if you like, and I felt they were getting really truthful answers. But
can I come back to saying, nobody would say that they were getting good advice, and that they weren't truthful. Nobody said that at all, and it was a kind of distortion to imply that that's what Stephanie did with the chair. Wasn't saying this. I can remember many, many years ago when we had a thing called the Community Health Council, which I was on for a while when I wasn't at work. And we went to all services to work. So we might have had a very, very good presentation about something, but it's our job to go and have a look at the patients and everything else. We were called the toothless tiger, but what we could do is better information. And I think scrutiny is in a similar sort of situation. And I would have said, it says here, advocacy. We have nobody from any of the advocacy places here to speak. They might have given us some more insight. It's great to know that things are going well when you've got a group of people telling you they're going well. But I think we needed to see a little bit around a picture. I'm sure you all have wonderful answers of why that didn't happen, and I'm sure we'll hear them. But I'm just saying, from my view, I like to read around the subject, and I also like to, if I'm hearing people, I like to hear around the subject, which is one side of it.
Christina, I'm not disagreeing with you, and I think actually that's quite a good idea if we can prove that, put that in the recommendations. I think that would be useful. I'm going to take, did you want to come back on that?
Yeah, just if I remember correctly, Chair, we did actually discuss, didn't we, at the workshop, if we could get in touch with advocacy groups or patients about their experience of the service, then that would be really helpful. So that's definitely not my place to say what we can do with that.
It actually does say that,
is the procedure of inviting different groups. So how do we go about inviting different groups? Can we set down a procedure? Because I might want a certain group to come, someone else might want a certain group to come. So there must be a procedure for inviting their groups.
I don't know what that procedure is, but we'll find out. I would say initially it's going to be through the chair. So if you bring it to the chair, and then we can discuss it, take it from there. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Reflected on the recommendations, also on page 61. At this stage, we have through the arrangements to council, and members have looked at the arrangements and satisfied themselves. I think it would be wise if we looked at a further recommendation, which I'll move slowly because I've scribbled it. And that would be to ensure that members of this and the Children's Services Overview and Scrutiny Committee are kept informed as to the experience gained during the operation of these arrangements and any modifications or variations suggested. I'm going to say that because we've got a scheme in operation. We might be enjoying any operation, we might move small sums of money around or large sums of money around, or might gain that this particular answer to our blocking problem or delay transfer, we need to alter it in some way. We might move some money from one part of the budget to another by agreement in cooperation with our colleagues in health. And those are learning things. We've got this year to learn, and possibly another year to follow, because it's a certain expiry date for the arrangements. And if things are picked up from when it's operating and could be improved, then we'll be kept informed. Do I read out what I scribbled down?
That's
fine,
if you can pass them over to Patrick.
I'll write it out each later, with a magnifying glass. What I've suggested that Clause 3, that members of this and the Children's Services Overview and Scrutiny Committee be kept fully informed on the experiences gained during the operation of these arrangements and any modifications or variations that are made.
Thank you, Phil. And I think that might fit actually in recommendation one. So we'll, if you can have that, please, Patrick, that would be great.
Yes. Thank you.
Okay, so we're now moving on to agenda item four.
On number one, recommendation one, if we agree this, does that mean this is our next meeting we will have that sort of information?
So what we're signing off is arrangements for 2019 to 2020, which start in March. So 1st of April, sorry, is the new municipal year, which these arrangements fit for. So we threw the new estate to that in terms of scrutiny. So these arrangements will be in place for that first.
So I understood that the section 75 that we had was from last March and hadn't been signed.
This paper is, as you know, Christina, you had meetings for 2019 to 2020. Full council agreed the arrangements for 2018 to 2019 on the basis of a vote, so then that just carries on as it was. There's absolutely no reason why we can't bring a motion paper here, and I'm absolutely happy to do that. But this specific paper and this specific recommendation is for 2019-20, because this is what we're making the decision on 18-19.
The reason why I'm asking is because, of course, the March one, we should have signed it, signed last year, will have implications for 2 or 3 years. Therefore, it'll be on the way anyway, so we really need it before it starts in April, don't we?
We'll have a look at that at the next meeting to see whether we can include everything for the next meeting in March. Thank you. Tony, I will move on to the next agenda item. Okay, which is item number four, motor pressure arrangements at Clatterbridge. And I understand we have Anthony Hibberton, the Chief Operating Officer, to introduce that report.
And hopefully it's a bit more of an explanation rather than just the winter. This is actually changing the visual
service. Yeah, would you mind just
perhaps
bringing the mic a little
bit closer? Yeah, sure.
We'll be able to hear as well. Thank you.
Is that better? Okay, good. As I was saying, hopefully, I'm not tackling winter, more of a classic image, but actually, it's also much more than feeling, really. And hopefully, the paper is self explanatory. But I just wanted to give you a bit of background as to a bit more of the rationale for it. So Wirral Hospitals currently has 792 acute beds open. And at any one point in time, there's about 100 patients which are classified as medically optimised. So they're approaching their end of stay with us at the hospital. They no longer require consultant medical staff input, nor indeed do they necessarily need registered nurse input. But they are stepping down to home care or into a nursing home or somewhere else. But they currently reside within an acute hospital. Now these patients are not cohorted. They reside on wards that predominantly they were admitted on whatever particular condition that may be respiratory or general medicine, whatever. And what that does for us as an organisation is it presents a logistical challenge because we're having to provide staff to be available to care for those patients, but they're not actually the right type of patients, nor indeed do we have the staff to deal with the bed base of that size. Now, 100 patients out of 792 beds is a significant figure. What I would say is that's not disproportionate to any other acute hospital. And actually, the vacancy rate for our nurses within Wirral is actually better than most places in the country. But nevertheless, it still stands that we have a 7.5% vacancies of our entire band 5 ward nurses. So that's about 170 members of staff that we have that are vacant. And the way we backfill that is that we ask staff to do additional work, or what we called Staff Bank, only calling agency nurses. And that's not always reliable. We can often get people just not turning up the shift on that basis. So we run our wards on minimum staffing levels throughout a significant period of time. So that's just the reality of what it's like within an acute hospital. As I say, it's not particularly unusual at Wirral or anywhere else. But going into this winter, as everyone's well aware, it puts increased pressure on all aspects of health and social care. But the ask for us as an acute provider was that we needed to provide an additional 48 beds, the best part of two wards, to cope with the normal seasonal increase in demand. And we as an organisation would not have been able to mobilise the workforce to deliver that additional capacity. So started looking at alternative methods of providing that capacity. And one of the things that we latched onto was that if we could cohort some of these medically optimised patients and provide an alternate or source an alternative provider to provide the care for those patients, then that wouldn't be a draw on our existing staffing levels. It's not necessarily an unusual approach, but it has been done in many other trusts around the country. And indeed, the concept of a T2A bed already exists out in the community settings already. But this was different in that we were going to use a mothballed ward within the acute setting of Clatterbridge Hospital, and we will source purely the staffing complement. So that's the process that we adopted. We went out for tender over the early summer part of last year. There was a number of bidders that put in, and we went through a comprehensive contract award process, and we awarded the contract to Four Seasons Healthcare. They were a provider of this type of facility on the Wirral already, so we've got a track record of working with these providers in the past. That opened on the 21st of November. See now it's been open for a little over 2 months, and the feedback that we're getting from patients is that it's a very nice ward to be on. It's, as you'd expect, it's not an acute general medicine ward, so that turnover that you get throughout 24-hour period of patients constantly being admitted and discharged via Rennie and everywhere else is not there, because it's a set-down facility. The turnover is much, much slower. So the average length of stay in that ward is about 3 weeks before the patient then goes on to care elsewhere. It's a different regime in that you've not got daily medical ward rounds, so it feels like you're stepping down. And the CQC visited it just before Christmas and rated it as good on every single aspect of care and safety and patient's experience. So that's effectively where we are. We awarded a 2-year contract for that. And I'm quite willing to take any questions on the rationale already for the part of that.
Okay, thank you for that. I think there will be quite a few questions. I mean, I'm going to indulge myself and say that the first question I have is, you talk about a project group to recommend the award contract to Four Seasons Group Holdings. So, from what we're aware of, the CQC reports have been quite poor. So it's interesting to say that they've got a track record, and I'd perhaps like you to elaborate on where that track record is. But if you could please tell us who the project group was.
So the project group are the current providers of these type of services within the hospital. So that would be consultant medical staff, senior nurses, financial colleagues, etc. So there have been an internal panel properly constructed to form the award and NHS contracts of that nature.
Did you have expert advice from procurement?
Yes.
Do you have any questions, please?
Thank you, Joe. Thank you for the presentation. So, my questions are around the criteria awarded at page 21. My first question is just the criteria that's set. So, 60% compliance to specification, 40% cost. in terms of the overall with each of the different weightings, how is that set and basically how did you come to those different weightings?
So prior to any more of any contract work, we did something to ask that then we set out with our procurement people the basis of how we were to award the contract. So this will have been the same panel that awarded the contract that determined what is the most appropriate components to base their judgments upon. We, in this case, use a very similar contract award criteria that we use elsewhere in the NHS over in other areas like Salford and Leeds. Yes, we I'm not saying professional procurement advice on whether what we get is the names of the companies and the costs, etc. like that, but certainly we, you know, it's an open consultation and we provide feedback to those bidders and we can show the stories against each of the bidders.
I think that would be really useful because in the discussions before this, I think seeing the different criteria is the first step. Understanding, I guess, how the criteria go about. I think the question was fine because each of these different quite specific areas are weighted, you know, it's not just for broad and they're quite specifically weighted. And we are unable as a result of this to see how four seasons scored against them and then how the other potential providers did. So if this could you be able to see this, I don't know how the people reach but then maybe if it comes back as a topic of conversation so that we can all ask further questions if we have them based on those numbers.
Yeah, thank you, Samantha. And whether you could perhaps provide those figures through to council, through Alex, and then it may be that actually we may ask you to come back for some further questions if you know if we feel the need. Just going on from what Samantha said, looking at the criteria and how you divided it, there's some really worrying things for me there when you. You know, okay, 40% is cost. When you actually look at how it's broken down, we talk about staffing and leadership, you're only waiting 4% on that. Discharge planning, which this is partly to help with, is only 4%. And I'm amazed that patient experience is only 3%. So I think it would be good to get some insight as to why you've weighted it the way that you have, because it just doesn't seem to make sense to me for patient experience. Tony?
Yeah, going over the criteria, not just obviously this came about because of the lack of skilled, skilled nurses, training professionals. There's nothing in this criteria required any training, like a training matrix, future training. Also, can you tell me what IMT is? Please, I've got my understanding. And the last question, if I may, was CQC's previous reviews of any of the Four Seasons sites, certainly locally, were they taken into account? Because I just quickly Googled the site around the corner across from Badminton, it was, it's not good. It's not good at all. Revised grants improvements, and one there, 100 euro. Was that taken into account at the tender stage?
Yeah, so to try and answer those in detail, these are headings. So when it's got staffing and leadership, there's a whole raft of detail that we can expect from any potential bidder to talk about that type. So in terms of staffing, you know, it's an absolute criteria about the staffing levels that would be required on a 24/7 basis. And leadership, there will be certain requisites around the seniority of that leadership and the time that they had worked in that particular position. And they would have to demonstrate compliance against each and every one of them. That's how we would score them. That's why we end up with varying points awarded for each of those sections. IMT is information technology, so that's the ability to have systems which integrate well with ourselves. They also have the ability to use it. They've got necessary qualifications, they've got necessary platforms and interconnectivity that
Clements, October.
Was the CQC previous?
So the CQC rating, yeah. So prior to the award of the contract, the CQC was involved in two aspects. So one was they needed to inspect the actual location themselves, and they also needed to give advice on the supply and stuff. So I know exactly what you're saying in terms of individual homes that vary in ratings, requires improvement, good, etc. around the country. And that would be the same for any DP provider or any community provider. But there was none at that point that were inadequate. At that point.
One in Bevington, just around the corner, that sorry, Chair. Sorry, Tribune. There was one in Bevington that I called a Bevington care home on Heath Road that had requirement.
Requires improvements.
Yeah.
I failed on
caring for people safely and protecting them from harm, quality and suitability and management, which is in your own criteria, and I failed on that in a home around the corner. Do you think maybe that should have been taken into account more so? And also as well, if the chain, there's no requirement for better chain and future staff.
That would be part of the absolute component of some of the elements that you talked about, operational policies, clinical governance, documentation, multidisciplinary working, and staff information, and all involve appropriate qualifications and continued professional development. The CQC element that you made reference to, the CQC rating is not a single rating for one home, that's what it's presented as, but beneath that, there's a huge matrix of components in different environments, safe care, responsiveness, effective, well-led, etc. With a whole load beneath that. So it was a requires improvement for that one, as you say, the one that you referenced. But we were not aware of any individual home that was related to the adequate, which would be in really special measures.
Could I just ask, you mentioned you've had a couple of, or you're aware that they deliver a couple of similar services such as this. Can you tell us where they are, please?
So they form Grove House. Grove House. Grove House, it's called. And there are other ones around the country, but that's certainly the one that's local to us.
Just before I take some other questions, can I ask that you talk about, this is on page 19 for those following, in Wirral there's a commitment from key partners to integrate health and social care services. Can the beds provide opportunity? If you explain what you mean by providing opportunity to integrate with further providers, which providers are you talking about?
So at the moment we provide, so some of our services, of these facilities and within the acute hospital, we integrate with providers, within that GPs, that provide support into some of these units and wards, with the community trust, with primary care, with social care, etc. So we've got.
I do have I do have concerns around the opportunity worker, if I'm quite honest, so we may need to keep a close eye on that. I'm now going to take questions from Sharon, Wendy, and Phil. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. I'm looking on to the presentation. I've got three questions for you. Sorry. On page 20, last paragraph, which I just don't copy down. It says, what was not needed was the hospital consultant, medical staff, nor registered acute nursing staff. What does registered acute nursing staff mean exactly to you?
So for me, these are nurses that are predominantly in the medicine and acute setting of the hospital, and the hospital consultant staff. So that's not to say that there are nurses that work in the community or other settings, but they don't need that that high acuity that many of our nurses and consultant staff care for on the point of admission in that earlier stage of treatment for our patients.
Thank you. through you, Chair, does that mean that there are registered nurses working on the board at all times?
Yes.
Yes, 24/7.
Yes.
And what ratio of nurses to registered nurses to unqualified healthcare assistants do you have on board?
Do you know on our part or on this particular ward?
On this particular ward.
I've got off the top of my head, I couldn't articulate that, but I can certainly get back to you. Certainly on the main wards, the expectation is that one registered nurse will care for six patients. In this setting, that's diluted to 1 in 8.
1 in 8.
So, Chair, can we just have clarification on that? Can we not first,
Christina? Thank you.
Sorry, can I just ask?
Can we just let Sharon finish first, please, Christina?
And the final question, because of the nature and the type of patients, and they still are patients, you know, in the hospital, but obviously they're waiting for discharge, you know, to a more social care setting, really. How does that fit in with the better care fund and financial responsibility with the council sharing any of that responsibility, really, the financial responsibility? How does that work?
So, at this point in time, so the way that the hospital is remunerated is under PBR tariff. So, you know, for every patient, they will have a certain level of income charged to them. And there's no distinction between whether or not they're receiving acute care or in the final stages of their stay with the hospital. In terms of this solution that's been put in place, the patients are discharged by the hospital. And they're transferred to this facility, the hospital bears the cost of that.
So at that point, they're still classed as an NHS patient?
No, they're discharged to the care of Four Seasons, but those beds are not commissioned by the CCG or the local authority. They are paid for from the union trust, which is a break from the normal plan. So the other 100 or so, C2A beds that exist within the community, they are commissioned direct from the CCG and the local authority.
These 48 are?
Well, there's 30.
30.
So just fact, it's 30 and it's only 18 were the ones that were provided within the community.
Thank you very much.
Can we
just have a
question?
Yes, please.
Not
yes.
This is
the
question.
No, I understand.
Just want clarity on what you said, because you confused me a little bit by mentioning the hospital and this. Now, given that this is separate, it just happens to be on Castlebridge site, what is the ratio of registered nurses to